there's the Russia we know. The Russia that spans all the way from Europe through the Middle East, all across Asia, shares a border with North Korea, and eventually ends up here at the Bering Sea. But there's also the Russia we don't know. These people, places, and cultures are all very different, both from each other, but also from what we perceive as Russian. And that's because they are. They reside in parts of Russia that are almost completely autonomous, and they're strangely not that much known about them. These parts of Russia are known as republics. There's 22 of these republics. They are essentially countries within a country, as they have their own official languages, constitutions, national anthems, and can control their own natural resources. These hidden cultures are what I would like to show you, mostly because I find them interesting and fascinating, but also because they are slowly disappearing for a reason I'll reveal later. But instead of talking about all of the 22 republics, I'll show you the ones I find most interesting. That includes the largest, most disputed, most populated, most exotic, and the most diverse. So, what better place to start than Crimea? The Russian Republic that isn't internationally recognized as a Russian Republic, as the status of Crimea is disputed. It is claimed by Ukraine and recognized as Ukrainian by the United Nations and most other countries. But in February 2014, following the 2014 Ukrainian Revolution that ousted the Ukrainian president, Viktor Yanukovych, Russia annexed Crimea after a military intervention by pro-Russian separatists and Russian armed forces. A controversial Crimea-wide referendum, illegal under the Ukrainian and Crimean constitutions, was held on the issue of reunification with Russia. Its official results showed over 90% support for reunification. However, the vote was boycotted by many loyal to Ukraine and declared illegitimate by Western governments as well as the United Nations. But despite this, Russia formally annexed Crimea on the 18th of March 2014, incorporating the Republic of Crimea and the federal city of Sevastopol as the 84th and 85th federal subjects of Russia. Following these events, however, Ukraine used the Crimean geography against them by cutting off the North Crimean Canal that provided 85% of Crimea's drinking water. Because of this, there's been a massive shrinkage in the area under cultivation in Crimea, from 130,000 hectares in 2013 to just 14,000 in 2017. But even though Crimea has a very long and complex history, and the status of Crimea is heavily disputed, I still want to include it, because the geography, climate, and people of Crimea are all very fascinating. You see, Crimea is only naturally connected to Ukraine by the Isthmus of Perekop, a narrow strip of land just 5 kilometers wide, which almost makes it an island. Crimea also has mountains and subtropical weather, not something you'd normally associate with Russia. Crimean Tatars, a predominantly Muslim ethnic minority who in 2014 made up roughly 10% of the population, was formed in Crimea in the late Middle Ages. The Crimean Tatars were, however, forcibly expelled to Central Asia by Joseph Stalin's government as a form of collective punishment. And after the fall of the Soviet Union, Crimean Tatars began to return to the region. Today, 16% of the population are Ukrainian and 68% are Russian. But as I mentioned earlier, Crimea is really hot, so maybe we should move on to a different republic, with a climate that much more resembles the climate we would expect in Russia. This is Yakutia, or Sakha. As you can see, it's pretty big. In fact, it's the largest political entity in the entire world that is not a sovereign nation. If it were a country, it would be the 8th largest country, between Argentina and India. So yeah, it's pretty f***ing big. Here, the largest ethnic group is the Yakuts, representing roughly 50% of the population, followed by 38% of Russians and then a bunch of other minorities. They have two official languages, Russian and Yakut, the latter being spoken by around 40% of the population, and is actually a member of the Turkic language family. The people here are probably the most East Asian looking in all of Russia. They hold on to traditions such as their colorful costumes, food, and summer festivals. One of these festivals is Isyak. That is an important festival for families who reunite over pancakes, horse meat, dried or fried fish, and kumis, which is a fermented mare's milk. Attendees at this festival wait in line for hours to press themselves up against the chief sarch, a sort of ritual pillar, to ask the spirits of nature for grace and miracles. The capital city of Yakutia is fittingly named Yakutsk, and this is quite the city. It's the coldest large city in the world, with an average temperature of minus 8 degrees Celsius. Although in January, the temperatures can go as low as minus 38 degrees Celsius. Now that is cold. And it's therefore the largest city in the world that is in continuous permafrost. Because of this, food preservation isn't really an issue, although cooking the food might be. Yakutia is, however, home to more than just cold weather and festivals. These are diamond mines, and this mine in particular is the Mirny Diamond Mine, which also happens to be the second largest man-made pit in the world, at a depth of 525 meters and a diameter of 1.2 kilometers. This mine is, however, no longer in use after it flooded in 2017, but you'll find plenty other mines all across Yakutia that include both underground and open pit mines, mostly due to Yakutia being so big. But despite its size, it's not the most populated republic. That title goes to Bashkortostan, with a population size of around 4 million. It's located here, pretty close to Kazakhstan. Now, even though a lot of people live here in Bashkortostan, it's still a place with insane geography and nature. Examples of this include the 2,700 lakes and reservoirs, as well as the 13,000 rivers, and multiple mountains that are all found here. In terms of ethnicity of the population, 30% are Bashkirs, 36% are Russians, and 25% are Tatars, and the remaining 9% consists of multiple minorities. Bashkortostan has a rich culture and history surrounding dance and music, which explains the extensive network of national theaters, museums, and a number of annual folk festivals. The capital city is Ufa, where roughly a quarter of the population lives, and this is where you'll find Russia's largest oil refineries. But what about religion? Well, you might have noticed that I haven't discussed religion yet, and the reason is that I saved it for the most diverse republic of Russia, Dashistan. This republic is located north of Azerbaijan, and with a coastline to the Caspian Sea, Dashistan is home to more than 30 ethnic groups and 81 nationalities. For this reason, it's considered one of the most linguistically and ethnically diverse republics of Russia. But in terms of religion, it's actually not as diverse as you might think, considering 83% of the population adheres to the same religion, although not Orthodox Christianity, which is the largest religion in the rest of Russia. Instead, the people of Dashistan adhere to Islam, which is likely due to the geographic location of Dashistan and its close proximity to the Middle East. And because of this location, it's pretty warm in Dashistan, at an average temperature of 26 degrees Celsius in July. Quite the opposite of what you would find in Yakutia. And while we are on the topic of temperature, let's move on to the other exotic republics in Russia that are located here with an extensive coastline to the Black Sea. What's fascinating about this region is that it's actually possible to grow tea here. Yes, tea is grown in Russia. I was also confused when I first saw tea plantations here, but it's real, and Russia is actually a surprisingly large consumer of tea, considering they are fifth on the tea consumption per capita list. Although you'll find more than just tea plantations here, as this is a region rich in oil, natural gas, gold, silver, tungsten, and iron, which are all valuable resources. But despite this, it's still one of the poorest parts of Russia, with a GDP of around $3,800 per capita. And that isn't much, but it's a trend we see in most of Russia's republics, even though they should be generating significant amounts of money from the natural resources they have access to. But in recent years, this has not been the case. Add to that a diminishing right to self-governance and autonomy, and you'll begin to understand there's something going on here. And it actually started 2 decades ago, on Vladimir Putin's election on the 26th of March 2000. This was the start of a period of extensive reforms to centralize authority with the federal government and bring all the republic's laws in line with the Russian constitution. His first act as president was the creation of federal districts, which were tasked with exerting federal control over the country's republics. Putin later established the so-called Cossack Commission in June of 2001 to examine the division of powers between the government and these regions. The commission's recommendations focused mainly on minimizing the regional autonomy and transferring lucrative powers meant for the republics to the federal government. Centralization of power would continue over the years as the republics gradually lost more and more autonomy to the federal government. Furthermore, in June 2018, a bill was passed that elevated the status of the Russian language at the expense of other official languages in the republics. And with all of this in mind, it's obvious that Putin is determined to completely get rid of these republics, their cultures and languages to gain complete control over all of Russia, which is why these republics might not survive for much longer.